Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Ghostwritten by Ronald Malfi, narrated by Joe Hempel. The most essential gift for a good writer is a built-in, shock-proof shit detector. Ernest Hemingway. Books have power. The cleaner. The skin of her teeth. 1. We've got a problem, said Jack Bear. They were the first words out of his mouth, even before he sat down at the table. Gloria eyed him coolly as she steeped her tea. They were at Antoine's, Jack's request, and the breakfast crowd was queuing up at the door and curling around the block on this warm September morning. Jack Bear queued for no one. In fact, he seemed oblivious to the people filing into the restaurant all around him. Gloria Grossman had known Jack for the better part of a decade, though his reputation in the industry had preceded any formal introduction. He'd been a top player at CAA before opening his own boutique literary agency, and he had, from time to time, courted Gloria, enticing her to join him. Merger was how Jack put it, framing the word in the air with his big hands to get her to visualize the marquee. But Jack had a reputation for representing difficult clients, which presented a whole host of headaches Gloria did not feel like shouldering. Ironically, it was her client, the screenwriter Davis McElroy, who was the cause of today's meeting and any headache that would inevitably follow. Hello to you too, Jack, Gloria said, plucking her teabag from the cup and tucking it along the rim of the saucer. I'm sorry, Glor, Jack said, reaching across the table and squeezing her hand. I'm a bit frazzled this morning. How have you been? How's Becca? Is everyone well? Gloria pulled her hand out from beneath his, enjoying the sound of his heavy Rolex knocking against the tabletop. A waiter came over, and Jack ordered an espresso and a bagel. Davis McElroy, Jack said, once the waiter had departed. What are we going to do here, Glor? Any word from him? Please say yes. No, I haven't heard from him. She was careful not to make it sound like some sort of admission of failure on her part. Also, she was cautious not to allow her own aggravation to show. If she was going to curse her client, she'd do it in private. Jack cleared his throat. Haven't you tried to reach? Of course I have, she said, cutting him off. I've sent emails. I've left voicemails. Although, I'll be honest, Jack, it's not unusual for him to be unresponsive when he's up at the house working on a project. Is he, though? Jack said, arching one slender steel-wool eyebrow. Is he working on the project? Because he's a month past his deadline, and the studio doesn't want to renew the option. Not with McElroy attached. He's been MIA for several weeks, maybe more from what I can tell, and the execs aren't getting the old warm and fuzzy anymore. He's put the whole project in jeopardy. Don't exaggerate, Jack, she said, and now she reached out and squeezed his hand, grinning condescendingly. Don't play me, Jackie boy, she thought. Thing was, Jack Bear was right. Davis McElroy had been MIA. Hell, McElroy might have fallen off the face of the earth for all Gloria knew at the moment. She hadn't heard from McElroy in over a month. He'd missed his last few scheduled Zoom meetings with the studio execs at Paramount, and he had been unresponsive to Gloria's repeated emails and phone calls warning him that his deadline to turn in his draft of the screenplay had come and gone, and that the option period was coming to a close too. Had it been another one of her former clients, old George Lee Poach, for example, who was infamous for his cocaine-fueled benders and periods of reclusiveness, Gloria wouldn't have been surprised. But Davis McElroy had always exhibited a steadfast work ethic, and he'd never missed a deadline. He was also 6 or 7 years into recovery, and as far as Gloria Grossman knew, he no longer ingested anything more potent than ibuprofen. True. He did not like to be bothered when he went up to the house, the hole in the wall, as he called it, to work on a project, but even his time up there had never precluded him from returning her calls or responding to her emails. Was it possible he'd fallen off the wagon? Lord knew Gloria had seen it a million times before. It was a goddamn cliche in this industry, and hardly the most unexpected thing to happen to a writer. Mr. Fish has also attempted to reach out to him personally, Jack said. The illustrious John Fish makes personal phone calls? I just assumed you did all the dialing for him, Jack, just like you cut and chew his filet mignon. Quip all you want, Gloria, but that should clue you into the severity of the situation. I'm not quipping, Jack. I just don't want you to pop a gasket. Jack frowned, rubbed a set of plump, hairy-knuckled fingers across the mottled ridge of his brow. John Fish was just the type of client that dissuaded Gloria from merging her agency with Jack's. The epitome of the pampered, pompous novelist who'd spent the bulk of his career marinating in white male privilege. She'd heard rumors that, while on a book tour, Fish insisted his hotel rooms be cleaned by his own team of hired professionals, and that the rooms themselves be stocked with a supply of assorted nuts, dried fruits, charcuterie, a vase of fresh daisies, scented toilet paper, and bed sheets whose thread count was never to be lower than 1,000. He was an asshole, in other words. But John Fish, and Jack for that matter, was right to be concerned. Davis McElroy had been hired by the studio to adapt Fish's best-selling novel, The Skin of Her Teeth, and he hadn't delivered. It was a mess all the way around. Is it possible something could have happened to the guy out there? Jack continued. Could he have had a heart attack or a stroke or something out there at the house? He seemed in good health to me last time I saw him, Gloria said. Anyway, it wasn't a heart attack or stroke she was worried about. To the best of her knowledge, McElroy didn't attend NA or AA meetings while tucked away up there in the hole in the wall like he did when he was here in the city. Maybe the damn fool had slipped up. Well, somebody needs to get in touch with the son of a bitch, Jack insisted. Maybe you should call the local police up there, have them drop by for a welfare check or something. Make sure the poor bastard isn't lying dead on the floor and that his dog hasn't made a meal of his corpse. I don't believe he has a dog. It was meant to be humorous, but it missed the mark. I wish I could share your confidence here, Gloria. Whatever is going on, it's bad business. And it's making Fish uncharacteristically, let's say, itchy? Gloria laughed. Itchy, huh? He's troubled by this whole thing. He keeps asking if we've heard from McElroy. It's not like him to give such a shit, to speak frankly. I didn't even think he knew Davis McElroy's name, let alone the guy's phone number. Jack's espresso and bagel arrived, borne on a linen-covered tray. The waiter set the items on the table, and Jack picked up the espresso, his squat, rectangular pinky extended. The cup looked like a miniature novelty in his oversized hand. No one's calling the police, she told him. If McElroy had relapsed, she didn't want to invite any legal complications into the equation. McElroy could be up there feasting on a buffet of cocaine and Jim Beam for all she knew. Cops would just muddy the waters. But I agree that enough's enough. I've already made up my mind to go out there myself and check up on him. Jack's eyes widened over the rim of his espresso. To the house? He said, setting the cup down. It's not Beirut, Jack, she said. She'd been up to the hole in the wall on a few occasions, whenever McElroy would throw one of his solemn, somewhat self-pitying get-togethers. She had the address in her phone. It was only a few hours' drive, and it would do her good to get out of the city for a while. She didn't own a car, though, so she'd have to butter up to Becca. Jack just shook his head. This whole thing sets me on edge, he commented, gazing at the traffic in the street now. His small eyes darted here and there, here and there. I don't want to lose this deal. We're not going to lose the deal. I'll handle it, Jack. In the meantime, she said, you take care of the studio. Keep them placated and on the line. I'll deal with McElroy. I won't come back from that house without the script. And what if he hasn't written the damn thing? You're such a pessimist, Jack, she said, but was already thinking the exact same thing. 2. A day trip, Becca said, not a question, half-moon glasses perched along the edge of her slender, ski-slope nose. Seated behind an economical aluminum desk, ugly but functional, Gloria supposed, in her office at the university, Rebecca Carroll looked every bit the career academic she'd been for the past 2 decades. Somewhat of a bribe, Gloria had brought Becca lunch, a bean sprout and avocado sandwich on rye and a kale shake from Antoine's. And she watched as Becca alternated between nibbling the sandwich and consulting an imposing textbook splayed open on her desk. Behind her, a pair of bookshelves, dense with heavy leather-bound volumes, looked like they might avalanche down on Becca at any moment. I wish it was as pleasant as it sounds, Gloria said, and then she explained the situation with Davis McElroy. Becca remembered McElroy and knew of McElroy's house upstate too. She'd been Gloria's date at one of McElroy's tedious soirees. But she professed concern with the notion of Gloria traveling out there on her own. If this guy is messed up on drugs or something, I'm not sure it's the smartest thing in the world for you to go waltzing right into the middle of that glore, Becca said. Worst case scenario, he's strung out and needs a cold shower, Gloria said. No, Becca countered, glancing up from the textbook. Worst case scenario, he's dead. Or he comes at you swinging a hammer because he's blotto on smack and thinks you're Julius Caesar. Gloria laughed. Blotto on smack? Where'd you glean that gem of a phrase? Laugh if you must, my dear, but you know I'm right. Why not wait for the weekend? We can drive up together, make a mini vacation out of it. What's that word? Vacation? Sounds vaguely familiar. A nice day at a bed and breakfast with those crumbly biscuits and a veritable library of teas, Becca continued. Sounds nice, but this can't wait. The studio doesn't want to extend the option. But I'm hoping that if he's actually written the damn screenplay, I can deliver it and maybe salvage this whole thing. You really think that's a possibility? That I can salvage this thing? That he's actually written it? I mean, it would be awfully considerate of the guy to postpone his alleged coke binge until after he's finished the screenplay, but I seriously doubt that's the case. Addicts aren't generally known for their accountability. Well, I can't just throw my hands up in the air and do nothing, Becca. There's a lot riding on this deal. Besides, that's just not my style. You of all people know that. Becca sighed audibly. She closed her book and wrapped the remaining half of her sandwich in the crinkly brown paper it came in. Yes, right. I know that, Glor. I'm just concerned, that's all. And I really think it will be fine. Now, can I please borrow your car? Of course, Becca said, scooting back in her chair and sliding open a desk drawer. But I also want you to borrow something else. The thing Becca placed on the desk looked like a black metal pipe about 4 inches in length. It was an expandable baton, like the kind police officers carried. Technically illegal in New York, but Gloria knew Becca didn't much care for laws that impinged upon her personal safety. Gloria shook her head and smiled. Ah, Becca, your penis be good stick. However will you keep rapists and similarly unsavory characters from assaulting your person as you walk home? Don't patronize me, Gloria. Take the damn thing. Who knows what's happening up at that house? You may need it more than me. And listen, give me a call when you get there, okay? Not that I'm trying to smother, I just want to know you're all right, and this McElroy fellow hasn't burned the place to the ground or anything. Gloria agreed to call, and agreed to take the penis be good stick, too. Becca handed over the keys to her Lincoln Nautilus and the cipher code to get it out of the garage. Gloria tucked the keys and the baton into her purse, gave Becca a quick peck on the lips, then hurried off. 3. The only stressful part of the drive was navigating the cumbersome vehicle through downtown traffic, but once she'd fled the city and was on the open road, she felt cool and collected. She ejected Becca's Annie DeFranco CD and replaced it with Sviatoslav Richter performing Chopin. She cranked the windows down and could almost convince herself that she would ultimately arrive at the hole in the wall and be provided with some logical excuse why McElroy had been incommunicado for so long. For all she knew, maybe the guy's cell phone died and he hadn't noticed because he'd been too preoccupied with work. Ditto why he'd missed the Zoom meetings with the studio executives. Could be that Davis McElroy was simply in the zone. Yeah, sure, she thought. She was trying not to let her anger overtake her, because really, that's what she was feeling. Not concern, not caution for her own well-being, but pure, mounting rage. A part of her hoped the son of a bitch was lying dead of a heart attack in that house, because he'd put her reputation on the line, not to mention a nice chunk of cash if this deal ultimately died on the vine. She could, in fact, excuse a heart attack or stroke. That sort of thing couldn't be helped. But the selfishness of a relapse? A drug and alcohol binge? That was goddamn inexcusable. She was reminded again of her former client, George Lee Poach, he of the pasty face, quivering jowls, and damp, eager hands, and of a specific phone call she had received from a perturbed events coordinator a few years ago, informing her that the venerable Mr. Poach was wholly intoxicated and wearing nothing but a tranquil grin as he attempted to order a calzone and a bottle of Knob Creek from the hotel concierge. Gloria didn't abide such bullshit. She dropped Poach as a client immediately after that ordeal. Let Jack Bear juggle the addicts, the booze hounds, the prima donnas. Gloria Grossman did not suffer fools. Still, Davis McElroy was not George Lee Poach. Yes, she had signed McElroy at the height of his addiction, something she hadn't realized he'd been suffering from at the time. But after a protracted stint in rehab, he had come out clean and sober and, to the best of Gloria's knowledge, had remained that way ever since. She'd seen the AA medallions on a small, wall-mounted shelf in his Manhattan apartment and recalled the uplifting, if somewhat cult-like, mottos he'd occasionally roll out in his languid, professorial voice. Until now, she would have considered Davis McElroy one of her more dependable clients. She forced herself to quit thinking about it, because her mounting irritation was ruining an otherwise pleasant drive. 4. She relied on the GPS on her phone to lead her to McElroy's house, although she could have probably found it on her own. It wasn't that she'd been here often enough to remember the way. It was that there was only a single private road that led up to the house, flanked on neither side by what looked like charming little peach trees. The house itself, the hole in the wall, materialized at the end of the road, a rustic yet well-maintained two-story cedar cabin with a slate roof dappled with skylights and a cobblestone chimney. It was too sophisticated and modern to be quaint. The updated renovations more on par with better homes and gardens than guns and ammo. Davis McElroy had done well for himself, in no small part due to Gloria's own innate talent for landing a solid deal. In some circles, she was known as the hostage negotiator, a moniker she secretly relished. McElroy's banana-yellow Triumph Spitfire was in the gravel driveway, and she could see nothing visibly amiss with the house. Not that she had expected to find it burned to the ground, as Becca had suggested, but still. She parked the Nautilus beside the Spitfire, then shut down the engine. Glancing up at the house, framed now in the Nautilus's polarized windshield, Gloria saw that the blinds on all the windows had been drawn. She unplugged her cell phone from the portable charger, killed the GPS app, then dialed McElroy's number. It no longer rang, as it had done all week, only went straight to an automated mailbox that was too full to accept new messages. Climbing out of the car, she took in a lungful of fresh country air, determined to keep her anger at bay. The air smelled of flowers and tasted clean. "We're all killing ourselves living in that city like a bunch of crazed rats nesting in a dump site," she thought, "and not for the first time. Our lungs are probably caustic from taxicab exhaust, and we're almost likely courting a dozen different types of cancer." She went up the porch steps and knocked on the front door. A semicircular window stood in the door at eye level, the glass tinted red like the window of a church. Gloria couldn't get a glimpse inside because the window was covered by an ugly paisley curtain. A sound then, a high-pitched motorized "ree," not from inside the house, but from someplace out here. "Please don't let that be a chainsaw," she thought, somewhat humorlessly. It would have been the exact thing Becca would have said upon hearing it. The sound died, revved up again, and died once more. "Hey," she shouted. "Hello? Davis?" No answer. She climbed down the steps and walked around to the side of the house. There was a massive oil tank here, red as a fire engine in a child's storybook, and several large sheets of plywood leaning at an angle against the side of the house. Another couple of steps, and she saw an upturned 5-gallon bucket in what remained of a fairly large watermelon that looked as if it had been hacked apart by an axe-wielding maniac. It gave Gloria pause. Becca's voice piped up in her head. "Worst case scenario, he's dead. Or he comes at you swinging a hammer because he's blotto on smack and thinks you're Julius Caesar." Funny at the time, not so funny now. And of course, Becca's patented penis bee good stick was still in her purse, which, in turn, was slumped on the passenger seat of the Nautilus. Fat lot of good it would do her here. Davis? Hello? It's Gloria Grossman. Anybody home? Davis McElroy was in his late 40s, Gloria's age, but exuded the youthful good looks of a man at least 10 years his junior. Those looks had earned him more than one cameo in a few of the movies he or his friends wrote. Once, even a speaking role, and he may have enjoyed a decent run as a second-tier actor had he not been such an introvert. But the man who stepped out from behind the house and into the harsh daylight looked nothing like Davis McElroy. That rugged frat boy air had vanished, leaving in its place a dark shiftiness, furtive as a wounded animal. He'd lost considerable weight. The open flannel shirt and Race for the Cure t-shirt hung from his wasted frame. His hair had exploded in a dark, unruly mop, bleeding down his face in the form of a spotty salt and pepper beard. His eyes looked haunted. Davis McElroy froze upon seeing her. He was holding some sort of tool or weapon in his hand, the sight of which did not help ease Gloria's sudden apprehension. It's drugs, all right, she had time to think. Son of a bitch. Gloria? He uttered, and even his voice sounded alien to her, aggrieved somehow. He took an unsteady step in her direction, shuffling along like someone unaccustomed to it. His eyes looked like they had strings attached at the back and someone was pulling them deeper into his skull. Gloria, what the hell are you doing out here? That's the question I came to ask you, Davis. Where the hell have you been? Where? It came out as a croak. He seemed confused as he managed another step in her direction. What have you got in your hands, Davis? He blinked, then glanced first down at his empty hand, then at the other one. He raised the item, but she still couldn't make out what it was. Some sort of metal pole or pipe? This, he said, it's nothing. It's a wood chisel. As if suddenly disgusted by it, he tossed the chisel on the ground. Davis, what the hell have you been doing up here? People have been trying to reach you. I've been trying to reach you. I drove up from the city to make sure you weren't dead. He said nothing. Just seemed to tremble there in front of her like something insubstantial enough to be carried off by a strong gust of wind. He glanced at something toward the rear of the house, something beyond Gloria's line of sight. Then met her stare again. Those bleak and anxious eyes appeared to quiver in their sockets. What is it, Davis? Cocaine? Pills? Or have you just been at the bottle? A vertical crease appeared between his eyebrows. He shook his woolly head. No, it's nothing like that. You realize you missed your deadline, don't you? My deadline? The screenplay, Davis? Please tell me you've got something to show me. Jesus, he said, the word wheezing out of him. Yeah, I know. I mean, I know I missed the deadline. It's just, time got away from me. You stopped answering your phone. Even John Fish was trying to call you. She'd mentioned this to shake him up, maybe drive home just how deep in the shit they were. It had the desired effect, given the expression that overcame his face. But when he opened his mouth, Gloria realized she had miscalculated. John Fish. The name all but seethed out from between McElroy's teeth. He glanced again at whatever kept attracting his attention behind the house, a tick that was making her increasingly uncomfortable. Then scratched nervously at his stubbled neck. What have you got back there? She asked him. Like a landed trout gasping for air, Davis McElroy's mouth opened and closed, opened and closed, and made a sickening bop, bop sound. Davis, she pushed. You shouldn't have come here. He took another step in her direction, a stagger, really. It's not safe. It's dangerous. She felt herself take an instinctive step back from him. What's dangerous? She asked. There was a beat of silence. When he spoke, he did so just barely above a whisper, and Gloria couldn't be certain she heard him correctly. Sounded like he'd said, the book. I don't even go in the house anymore, except for when I have to put up a new wall, he said. then nodded to a small brick structure no bigger than an outhouse farther down the property. "Been sleeping in there, where it's safer." He took another step in her direction, and she took another step back. "Been eating out here, too," he continued, and nodded toward the overturned bucket and the decimated watermelon. "Davis, I think I should call someone and get you help. Would that be okay?" "Help," he said, the word sounding like it had come unstuck from the roof of his mouth. "Help would be nice." To Gloria's horror, he collapsed to a seated position in the grass and began to weep. Every instinct told her to bolt back to the car and get the hell out of there. She could call the goddamn cops from the highway, have them come and collect the son of a bitch. But she didn't do that. She was on the hook now, her curiosity about what Davis kept glancing at behind the house besting any impulse of survival. Besides, she couldn't leave here without the screenplay. She stepped around him, one cork-heeled sandal brushing the watermelon rind and setting it rocking. It was a pleasant day on its way toward a cool and clear evening. The air had been scented with lilac just moments ago, but as she turned the corner of the house and crossed into the backyard, she caught a whiff of sawdust and overheated electrical equipment. There was a flagstone patio back here that led to a set of double doors at the rear of the house. These doors both stood wide open now, and there was some sort of construction project erected on the patio in front of them. A pair of sawhorses hoisting one of those sheets of plywood, a scattering of 2x4s lying on a bedding of sawdust, a circular saw that must have accounted for the mechanical whine she had heard from the front porch. She looked down, saw her shoe had gotten tangled around a loop of orange electrical cord, and shook it loose. There was something inside the house, just beyond those wide open double doors. That would be the parlor, she recalled, a den with exposed wooden beams in the ceiling and a cobblestone fireplace to match the chimney. When she and Becca had been here last, a year ago? McElroy had taken to outfitting the entire room in a garish Navajo motif that didn't quite jibe with the rest of the house's modern design. McElroy, clutching a rocks glass of spring water with a twist of lime, had laughed at Gloria's expression as she'd run a hand along the woven Native American blanket folded over the back of his Naga hide sofa. "Yeah, I know the place looks like a ski lodge," McElroy had said. "I never did have a sense for fashion, but I like what I like." She stepped over the piles of sawdust and a scattering of bent, discarded carpentry nails and approached the open doorway. What looked like an enormous wooden crate stood in the center of the room. In fact, it occupied the majority of the room, its top nearly butting against the exposed ceiling beams, its width expansive enough to run flush with the fireplace mantle. The Naga hide sofa was still here, but the crate had shoved it against one wall, its cushions torn and its frame cracked. The enormity of the thing, the inexplicable nature of what she was looking at, gave her a momentary flutter of vertigo. Whatever the crate was, whatever purpose it served, Davis McElroy had built it. She'd witnessed people do some crazy things while on drugs, but something about this troubled her on some deeper, inexplicable level. "I know how this looks," he said, startling her. He'd gotten himself under control, though his face was now mottled in red splotches from crying. He wavered there in the doorway like something insubstantial, like she might reach for him only to have her hand pass unimpeded through his body, ghost-like. Gloria turned away from him. She didn't like looking at his eyes. It was like someone else staring out from behind the mask of his face. "What is all this, Davis?" "Pandora's box," he said, looking past her and into the house, at the crate he'd built. "Despite the old adage, I guess you could say I'm trying to close it back up." A terrible notion occurred to her. Is there something in there? But she wasn't thinking something. She was thinking someone. "Christ, yes," he said. His voice sounded raw and exhausted. "I mean, it should. I hope it's..." He trailed off. She stepped into the room, could smell the cut wood, could see the pixie-like filaments of sawdust spiraling lazy in a shaft of fading sunlight. Because the crate was so tall, it looked like McElroy had amputated the chandelier from its housing in the ceiling, An eye socket that drooled out lengths of wire was all she could see up there. She stood on her toes and touched the top surface of the crate, felt the nail heads poking up from the wood, the splinters jutting from the 2x4 brace. She looked to her left and saw an antique end table smashed to kindling. There was the chandelier, too, a hideous artifact comprised of antlers, casually discarded on the floor in the hallway. She squeezed past the crate and leaned into the hall, caught a whiff of shit and spoiled food. No scent of booze, and no evidence of empty bottles anywhere. She withdrew back into the parlor. "Explain this to me," she said. David McElroy gazed at the massive crate. One of his eyelids twitched. He looked apprehensive, like he suddenly didn't want to be too close to it.
"I guess you could say I've trapped it," he said, "like a wild animal."
"Trapped what?"
"The book," he said.
"What book?"
A humorless chuckle burped out of him. "His book. John Fish. The skin of her—"
"Don't say it," he shouted, holding his hands up in a warding off posture. Gloria flinched as if he might strike her.
"Don't say it. Don't say it. It'll hear you."
"The book? The book will hear me?"
"You," he said. "Me, everyone, anyone."
He lowered his voice and said,
"It listens."
She pointed at the crate. "The book is in there?"
"I should hope. I hope so. It was at one time. I haven't seen any new holes, only—"
"Only what?"
"Only it's been chewing its way out. So I have to keep building walls around it so that it doesn't chew its way out and get free."
"Excuse me," she said. She pushed past him and went back out onto the patio. McElroy lingered inside a moment longer, then followed her outside. He winced when the sun struck his face. Turning his head, the sunlight reflected off his beard, causing one half of his face to shimmer like gold.
"I'm not crazy, and I'm not on drugs. You don't know what it's been like out here, Gloria. The things that have happened—"
"Tell me," she said. He coughed almost demurely into a fist, then said,
"It started soon after I'd begun writing the screenplay. Little things at first, the way a haunting in a movie will start small then gradually ramp up momentum. The book, at first, it would disappear. Or, no, not disappear. Relocate. Like something alive moving about the house. I'd find it in some other room under a bed, in a kitchen cabinet with the coffee mugs, in the bathtub. I thought I was losing my mind. Like, was I relocating the book to all these random places only to have no recollection of doing so? Were those memories wiped clean from my mind?"
There was another upturned 5-gallon bucket back here in the grass. Gloria went to it and dropped herself down onto it. "There used to be a wooden bench back here," she recalled. She looked out over the yard, naked and barren except for the unkempt grass, straight out to the swell of woods at the horizon. "The yard used to be dotted with bird feeders, too," she remembered. "At least a dozen of them. Those were all gone now, too." She was beginning to feel lightheaded.
"But that wasn't it," McElroy continued. "I realize that now. At first, you see, it was trying to get away. Fight or flight. It opted to flee. To escape. I didn't know it then, but that's exactly what it was doing. Was trying to do."
"The book," she said, just to make sure she was actually following this bizarre story.
"Yes, the book."
He ran a shaky hand through his mop of hair, then giggled like a child.
"My God, Gloria, do you realize? If I'd only understood what it was trying to do back then, I would have let it go. Can you imagine? Can you imagine how differently things would have turned out? I mean, if I'd realized what it was trying to do back then, I would have just let it go. But I didn't know. And then things got worse."
"Worse how?" she asked, though she was not so sure she actually wanted to know.
"It fucking bit me," McElroy said, tugging up the sleeve of his flannel shirt.
The wound in his arm looked less like a bite and more like someone had slashed him repeatedly with a blade.
Jesus, Davis, she said, horrified. Had he done that to himself? Yeah, I know. He fingered one of the slashes, now a crusty brownish scab. Doesn't really hurt, not now, just freaked me out more than anything, you know? How did a book do that to you? Again, he chuckled, a nervous titter. I know, right? But Gloria, it came at me. Hungry. Pissed off. I don't know. More than once, too. He bent and cuffed up one leg of his filthy carpenter's pants with both hands. His shin was swaddled in white gauze, at the center of which was a rose blossom of startling red blood, a much fresher wound than the ones on his arm. Gloria swallowed an intake of air. She covered her mouth with one hand. It wasn't just physical, either, McElroy said, dropping his pant leg. He tapped a finger against his temple, eyes blazing. It was getting in my head, too, twisting my thoughts, waging war on an internal scale like some kind of parasite. Sneaky fucker, right? I could even hear it chattering away inside my head, like an insect buzzing, like bug wings, but not really, because what it really was, you know, was the flittering of its pages. A realization struck her, that she had failed to call Becca upon her arrival as she had promised. It popped something in my head right behind my eye, he said, and pressed a set of fingers to his left eye socket. For the first time, Gloria noticed his hands were lacerated and bruised, the knuckles ridged with leaky crimson scabs. Blood gushed from my nose like a faucet, for hours. I eventually heated a metal cocktail stirrer on the stovetop, then stuck it up my nostril to cauterize. Davis, please, she balked, glancing away from him. I burned it in the fireplace, he said. The book, I mean. It came back. I tore it to shreds. It came back. She looked back at him. She shook her head. Don't you see? He said. I can't destroy it. It's impossible. He glanced over his shoulder and at the massive crate he'd built in the parlor. Forget about the book. Where's the screenplay, Davis? But listen, he went on, ignoring her. I tricked it, all right? I baited it like some fucking wild animal and I caught it. Then I built the walls around it. I could hear it moving around inside, chewing its way through the wood. So I put up more walls. Then more walls. Then more walls. He kept staring at the crate he'd built, a discomfiting mixture of pride and terror in his eyes. It's like he wants to cry and scream and laugh all at the same time, she thought. If it was so bad, why didn't you just leave the house, Davis? I did, he said. Once. I went back to the city for a few hours. See, a writer friend of mine, he gave me the name of some used bookstore on Worth Street in the city. Said the proprietor dealt in unusual books and that he might be able to help me. I laughed. Like, who the hell could help me, right? He snapped his fingers, loud as a gunshot. Finter, he exclaimed. That was the book dealer's name. What did he tell you? She asked, and thought, this Finter guy probably called the cops on you, Davis. That's what I should be doing right now, too. That the book wasn't just a book, McElroy said. That it was actually a vessel, a container for something else. And whatever was trapped in that book was angry and dangerous. No, Davis, he didn't say these things. He did, McElroy shouted. He wanted me to bring him the book, but of course I couldn't. I'd already trapped it, entombed it. I couldn't let it out again. I couldn't risk transporting it back to the city with me. Too dangerous. He shambled over to her and sat cross-legged in the grass beside the bucket. I know you think I've lost my mind out here, Gloria, and maybe you're right. I'm just afraid that if I stop putting up those walls. She looked at the construction equipment splayed out along the patio, then back at McElroy. It's time to stop, she told him. Do you understand? It's time to stop, Davis. He nodded, then hung his head. His eyes had filled with tears again, and those tears dropped onto the knees of his carpenter's pants as Gloria stared at him. Where's your laptop, Davis? No answer. He just sobbed quietly, his head downturned. Davis, we need the screenplay. Did you write it? Something akin to a laugh juddered out of him. Oh, brother. Yes, Gloria. Yes, I wrote the fucker, all right? I finished it. Relief flooded her. So where's your laptop? Without looking up, he raised a hand, pointed toward the brick building that looked like an outhouse. Gloria got up, crossed the overgrown yard, and saw that the door to the small brick building wasn't fully closed. She'd pushed against it, and it squealed open, revealing a tomb-like, windowless room that reeked of gasoline. Indeed, there was a lawnmower and a can of fuel in here, among similar items. A rake, a shovel, potting soil, some more tools. There was also a bedroll splayed out on a mattress of egg crate foam. Flies hummed over top a bucket half full of discarded food. A mound of unwashed clothes and a pair of Converse sneakers shunted into one corner. She identified the laptop, or what remained of the laptop, last. Any hope she'd had of salvaging this deal sank into the mire. The instrument McElroy had used to decimate the laptop, a hammer, rested on the concrete floor surrounded by jagged black teeth of plastic and sparkly bits of metal. The laptop's screen was a spiderweb of cracks, the keys from the keyboard stripped and scattered around like teeth knocked loose after a good punch. Not satisfied with smashing only the exterior, she saw that he had removed the hard drive and had annihilated it with the hammer. She returned to the patio to find McElroy still seated cross-legged in the grass, his head down. "Please tell me you've got it saved electronically somewhere," she said. "Please tell me it's in the cloud or in an email or something, Davis." "The screenplay?" he said, and glanced up at her, wincing as he faced the sun. "It's gone. I erased it. Destroyed it. It had to be done." "Why, Davis?" "I realized that's why it kept eating its way through the boxes. It was to get at the screenplay and destroy it. So I saved it the trouble." She turned away from him, strumming with anger. "I had to, Gloria," he said, and hung his head again. "I had to." 5. Gloria piloted Becca's Nautilus down the winding road flanked by peach trees, the visage of the hole in the wall shrinking in the rearview mirror. In the passenger seat, looking like someone dragged dazed from a fire, Davis McElroy gazed vacantly out the window and at the encroaching twilight. His eyelids kept sliding shut and his head kept bobbing against the passenger window, as if he might fall asleep at any second. By the looks of him, and by the looks of that uncomfortable bedroll spread atop a mattress of egg crate foam in the outbuilding, he probably hadn't gotten much sleep lately. Something occurred to Gloria around the time they were back on the highway. "Davis?" He jerked his head up from against the window. He'd been in and out of sleep for much of the drive already. "You said you baited it, like a wild animal," Gloria said. "What exactly did you use as the bait?" "Oh," McElroy said, rubbing at the corners of his mouth. "The screenplay." She glanced at him. "Yeah," he went on. "The book, it wanted the screenplay. That's what it came down to at the end of the day, you know? It wanted the screenplay, so I used it as bait to catch it." His laugh sounded like a shrill bark. "Fooled the son of a bitch real good, didn't I?" "So," Gloria said, "that means what?" "The screenplay is in the box," McElroy said. "Pandora's box, with the book." "In the box with the book," Gloria repeated. "Son of a bitch," she thought, and felt an inkling of hope buoy back up through the core of her body. A minute later, Davis McElroy was snoring like a champ. 6. Over the next 24 hours, Gloria donned her hostage negotiator's hat and went to work. She held a conference call with the studio execs in charge of the project, during which she relayed, in deliberately broad and ambiguous terms, that the screenwriter, Davis McElroy, had suffered a debilitating medical condition while at his home upstate. He was recouping now in his Manhattan apartment and under the care of a specialist. She could tell what the execs were all thinking. Hollywood was positively overflowing with screenwriters who suffered from periodic debilitating medical conditions, of course.
but she refused to confirm or deny any suspicions. Anyway, they were all happy to know that the screenplay was finished and would be delivered to them before the end of the week. By the end of the call, Gloria felt she had won them over. Baited was the term that came reluctantly to mind. Gloria's assistant tracked down McElroy's ex-wife, whom Gloria phoned immediately following the conference call with the studio. She made the call under the auspice of concern for McElroy's health, but in reality it was to create a legitimate backstory to the tall tale she'd spun for the studio execs. Gloria knew nothing about McElroy's ex. He had already been divorced from her by the time she'd signed him as a client, but it was clear in the first 30 seconds of the call that this was not a woman who was pining for the man to whom she'd once been married. "Lady, if you're calling to tell me that bastard is back to snorting junk up his nose and drinking himself blind, I couldn't give a shit. I hope he has a fucking coronary." Before Gloria could eke out another syllable, McElroy's ex-wife disconnected the call. Gloria stopped by McElroy's 10th Avenue apartment with a box of donuts and two coffees later that afternoon. It was a show of goodwill, but she also wanted to observe his condition in case he'd have to be marched out for another meeting with the studio heads in the near future. If he still looked like something that had fallen off a subway platform, she'd work around that. Say he was still dealing with his medical condition. Whatever it took. He'd slept for much of the drive back to the city the day before, and when he answered the door, he looked well-rested and peaceable. He smiled warily at her and invited her into the apartment. "I went to an AA meeting this morning," he told her as she followed him into the cramped kitchen nook. She set the box of donuts and the coffees on the table. "First one in about a month or so. It felt good." "Is that what all this has been about, Davis? Did you get caught up in all that again?" He looked down at the box of donuts, its bright pink cardboard like something not of this earth. Gloria could tell he was considering what to say or whether to say anything at all. Ultimately, he said nothing. "Well, whatever it is, I'm glad you're seeking help. Do you think you could set up a meeting for me?"
"A meeting?" she said, suspicious.
"With whom?"
"John Fish."
"Oh," she said. "You know, Davis, John Fish doesn't really take meetings."
"I know. I've heard all about him. But you said something about him trying to get in touch with me. And anyway, I just feel I owe him, I don't know, an apology? Or at least an explanation. I feel like such an asshole for killing this deal."
Gloria chewed on the inside of her cheek. She hadn't told him that she'd saved the deal. All she had to do was deliver McElroy's screenplay, which was currently buried inside a wooden box up at the hole in the wall.
"Please," he begged.
"I'll call Jack Bear, see what he says," she told him.
"Thank you."
"Are you sure there isn't a digital copy of that screenplay anywhere? Maybe on a thumb drive or something?" A shuddery breath escaped him. "Davis?"
"I told you," he said. "It's gone. I'm sorry about that, Gloria, but it had to be done. That book didn't want me working on it. It was like that book didn't want that screenplay to exist at all. It was trying to stop me."
He shrugged. He didn't meet her eyes.
"So I stopped."
Something like a lead weight descended through the core of Gloria's body. It was in that moment she realized just how hopelessly lost this man was. Right now, he looked sober as an archangel, yet he was still talking about that goddamn book like it was the devil himself. She made a show of looking at her wristwatch, then headed for the door. "Anyway, I gotta go," she said.
"You'll call Jack Bear? Promise?"
"Promise," she said, and fled that place. 7. She had no intention of having Davis McElroy meet with anyone, let alone John Fish, although she did pass along McElroy's request to Jack Bear during a phone call from the backseat of a taxicab headed uptown. "Understand that I'm not making this request, but merely relaying this to you as nothing more than an anecdote," Gloria said into her phone. "Whatever he's gotten into, Davis McElroy is in no condition to take a meeting. I was planning to tell him that Fish denied his request and leave it at that." Jack cleared his throat on the other end of the line. "Not so fast. Believe it or not, and I certainly don't, Gloria, Fish made the same request of me."
"You're shitting me,"
I shit you not, dear. Between you and me, I think there's something playing out behind the scenes here, although I can't for the life of me arrive at what it might be. Fish has been uncharacteristically preoccupied with this whole turn of events. It's not like him to give a shit, to put it bluntly, so of course my hackles are up. Can I ask you something? Sure, I just might not answer. What the hell happened out there at that house? Jack had been on the call with the studio execs earlier that morning, and although he was pleased that she had rescued the project, it was also evident that he didn't buy her bullshit song and dance routine about some vague medical condition. Between you and me, Jack, she said. He was in the middle of losing his mind out there. No, wait, scratch that. His mind was already gone by the time I got there. She was recalling what McElroy had said to her back at his apartment. That book didn't want me working on it. It was like that book didn't want that screenplay to exist at all. Drugs? Jack suggested. Probably. I don't know. I'm not his goddamn physician. And the screenplay? You'll email it over this afternoon? Listen, let's pretend we're in the golden age of Hollywood and I'm going to have a handsome young courier run you over a hard copy as soon as possible. The hell are you talking about, Gloria? She sighed. There is no digital file, Jack. The only copy has been printed out and is apparently back up at the house. McElroy's house? What the hell is going on over there? Don't worry, it's all under control. I'm going to retrieve it myself today. You'll have it as soon as I get back to the city and can run off a copy. Jesus, Gloria, and you're still of the opinion that my clients are the troublemakers? One rotten apple does not a rotten batch make, she told him. Who's that? Confucius? Go have a martini, Jack, and let me do what I gotta do. She heard him exhale on the other end of the line. The hell's going on? He said, and it came out more as an exasperated sigh than a legitimate question. I have no idea, she thought. I have no idea. 8. She brought Becca a chai tea latte, placing it on the edge of her ugly aluminum desk as a peace offering. They'd already sparred over Gloria's failure to call when she arrived at the hole in the wall the day before, a heated phone call that had taken place last night after Gloria had dumped McElroy off at his apartment. Gloria had downplayed the situation at the house to avoid further chastisement from Becca. Yes, the son of a bitch had been hitting the bottle again, but no, she hadn't been in jeopardy. Becca had only sighed. She'd wanted to remain irritated at Gloria, but couldn't. Instead, Becca lamented on the fragile male ego, quick to seek solace in a bottle. Becca eyed the latte like it might be a plastic explosive. What's this supposed to be? Another bribe? Gloria came around the desk, wrapped her arms around Becca's neck, kissed the side of her face. I need to borrow your car again today, she said. I knew it. You're so predictable. You should find that comforting by now. I find it manipulative. What do you need the car for this time? She explained that the only copy of the screenplay was a printout that was still up at McElroy's house. Becca lifted Gloria's arms away from her. She looked concerned. You're going back there? There's nothing to be worried about now, Becca. The place is empty. No fragile male ego to spring from the shadows and attack. You couldn't have brought the damn thing home with you yesterday. I didn't know it was there until we were halfway through the drive back to the city. The idea just doesn't sit well with me. Becca surveyed the paperwork on her chest. Maybe I'll take a sick day this time. Drive up with you. She didn't want Becca to see the state of that house. Don't be silly, she told Becca. Save your leave so we can run away together. And when will that be? Once I deliver the screenplay? You're like the Indiana Jones of talent agents. Yeah, well, this sucker doesn't belong in a museum. I need to get it to the brass at Paramount toot sweet. Just then, Gloria's cell phone chirped. A message from Jack Bear. Well, shit, she uttered. Becca said. What? John Fish wants to meet with McElroy this evening. Christ, that was quick. Is this good or bad? It's perplexing is what it is, she admitted. Looks like I'll have to postpone my road trip until tomorrow. That is, if you'll still let me borrow your wheels. Becca waved a hand at her. Thanks, sweetheart, Gloria said. She picked up the latte. And I apologize for the crude attempt at bribery. Leave the latte, Becca said. 9. She was standing outside Bertoli's in a smart pantsuit when a taxicab pulled up and McElroy climbed out. He had shaved, combed his hair, and put on a shirt and tie. Gloria was pleased and relieved to see the change in him. She smiled warmly when he noticed her standing on the sidewalk.
"How do I look?" he asked.
$1 shy of $1,000,000.
"In that case, you got a dollar I can borrow?"
They were 20 minutes early for the meeting, which was by design. The hostess brought them to a dimly lit corner of the restaurant where candles danced on the table in frosted glass jars. A waiter stood at attention beside the table, ready to serve. McElroy ordered a tonic water and lime juice. Gloria ordered the same, though she felt she could use a stiff drink.
"Couple of things," she said. "I don't know why Fish agreed to this meeting, but here we are. I think it's fine for you to offer your apology or whatever you want to call it, but let's keep things simple. You blame the bottle if you want to offer an explanation, understand? You had a little setback, fell off the wagon, and you're sorry for any trouble or inconvenience. That's it, Davis. John Fish is a notorious booze hound, so maybe he'll be sympathetic. I doubt it, but you never know."
McElroy nodded. "That shit about the book and that wooden crate you built around it, you keep that between us. Do you understand?"
Again, McElroy nodded.
"Lastly, the deal isn't dead," she said. "First thing tomorrow, I'm heading back up to that house and retrieving that screenplay. I don't want—"
"No," he said, a look of abject horror falling across his face. He actively withdrew from her as if she were giving off a poisonous gas.
"No, Gloria, you can't do that."
"I don't want to discuss it. I'm trying to salvage your career and my reputation. Do you understand? I won't humor any opposition on this, Davis. It's a done deal."
"You can't do it."
His eyes wide, he just shook his head.
"You can't."
"Calm yourself, or I'll cancel this meeting right now." McElroy just stared at her. Fear gleamed behind his eyes. She glanced at her wristwatch. "They'll be here soon enough. Go to the restroom, wash your face, gain some composure." When he didn't move from his chair, she said, "God damn it, go, Davis, or we're done here." He blinked his eyes as if to clear his vision, then ratcheted himself up off his chair. She watched him meander across the dark floor of the restaurant toward the restroom alcove, where he disappeared. When 10 minutes passed and he didn't return, she wondered if he'd snuck out when she wasn't looking. She found she was relieved by the prospect, but then she saw him small stepping out from the restroom alcove and across the floor to rejoin her at the table. He looked calmer, but she didn't like the way he drummed his fingers on the tabletop. 10 minutes later, Jack Bear was led to their table by the hostess. Alongside Jack, the imposing figure of John Fish advanced between the tables. He wore a dark suit and an intricately patterned necktie with a pearl tie clip. Fish was an enormous man, known for his love of food and liquor alike, and his formidable stature and prodigious girth did not fail to meet expectation. Gloria had met the man in person only once, at a lavish party thrown by some publishing executive. Fish had held court, pleased as a pharaoh to command such attention. He'd eaten voraciously at the party, Gloria recalled, the only guest at the host's dining room table, where he devoured an impressive slab of dinosaur meat, still red and squirting blood. They were 10 minutes late now, but Fish was clutching a drink in one meaty paw, which meant they'd been pre-gaming at the bar. Gloria stood as they approached. McElroy followed suit. The hostess pulled out a chair and Fish levered his bulk onto it. The rest of them sat. "Pleasure to meet you, Mr. Fish," Gloria said. "I'm a huge admirer of your work."
"Then you have exquisite taste," Fish said.
He grinned and his teeth, although yellow, were filed into perfect rows. His ample jowls bulged above the knot of his necktie. "Davis," Jack Bear said and extended a hand to McElroy. McElroy glanced down at Jack's hand, then looked furtively at Gloria beside him.
Christ, she had time to think, seeing the change come over McElroy's face. This was not the same man who'd stepped out of the taxicab less than a half hour ago. Was it possible he'd actually tricked her? Gloria Grossman, the hostage negotiator? Jack's smile faltered. He retracted his hand slowly, but then McElroy raised his own and gripped Jack's palm in a handshake. Later, Gloria would opine that John Fish would have been successfully murdered had it not been for that awkward, impromptu handshake. Davis McElroy was right-handed. As he shook Jack's hand, he groped for the steak knife that sat behind his plate with his left hand. He rose from his seat, still snared in that handshake, and carved a clumsy arc across the table with the steak knife. There was no question as to the intended target. John Fish. More specifically, John Fish's throat. But it was a stretch. Fish had been seated diagonally from McElroy at the table, and while that allowed for a closer proximity between John Fish's throat and McElroy's knife-wielding left hand, it was a ham-fisted attack. The knife did make contact. It swiped across the front of Fish's shirt, amputating the author's expensive-looking necktie in the process. Fish jerked backward, his drink toppling to the floor. Still pumping Jack's hand in a mad handshake, perhaps having forgotten that he was even shaking hands, McElroy bolted up onto the table, repositioning the knife for a follow-up attack. There was no swipe this time, but a sturdy and decisive downward stabbing motion that ultimately planted the blade of the steak knife in the vast, beefy quarter panel of Fish's left bicep. Jack Bear shrieked. Gloria sprung up from her chair. John Fish flailed in his own chair, the soles of his tasseled loafers scrambling for purchase on the lacquered wooden floor. McElroy advanced across the top of the table toward Fish, still clutching Jack's hand. Jack howled and tried to extract his hand from McElroy's death grip to no avail. The table gave way beneath McElroy's weight, sending the man crashing to the floor amid the shatter of glassware and the jangly eruption of clattering utensils. Jack finally yanked his hand free, and, clutching it to his chest, retreated backward until his backside struck a dessert cart. Plates of cheesecake and chocolate mousse toppled to the floor. John Fish struggled to raise his formidable girth from his chair, but his panic, coupled with his immense weight, prevented him from executing much more than a frantic little jig in his seat. The steak knife protruded from his upper arm, so preposterous it almost looked like a gag. On the floor, McElroy was scrambling to his feet, tripping and stumbling over the broken dishware and cutlery, ultimately becoming tangled in the linen tablecloth. Fire burned in his eyes, that same lunatic expression Gloria had seen when he'd first come around the side of the house, that wood chisel like a sword in his hand. John Fish's chair collapsed beneath him, sending the overlarge man toppling to a heap on the floor. Squeezing his injured arm, Fish's eyes were equally on fire, only with the flames of terror. A full-scale inferno. Somehow McElroy managed to get back up on his feet. He loomed over John Fish, advancing like something desperate and ravenous, and fueled by single-minded wrath. Someone screamed. Then Davis McElroy dropped back to the floor. He landed on his hands and knees, tried to get back up, but something drove him straight back down again. A moment later, he was supine atop the tablecloth and broken dishes, moaning in agony. Gloria didn't know what had happened until she realized she was grasping the hand grip of Becca's penis be good stick in one hand. She couldn't even remember retrieving it from her purse and swinging it. 10. Newspapers had a field day with the headlines. Bertoli's now serving filet of fish. And overzealous screenwriter cuts ties with novelist. And renowned author survives brutal attack by the skin of his teeth, and so on. John Fish's wounds were superficial and required nothing more than a handful of stitches. Repercussions for McElroy were more dire. He was arrested, charged with multiple counts of aggravated assault, attempted murder, and one charge of disturbing the peace. Gloria recommended a very good attorney who happened to be an old love interest back in the day, but did not insinuate herself in Davis McElroy's legal woes beyond that. She left the city early the next morning, before Becca happened to hear about what had transpired at Bertoli's on the morning news. Not wishing to stoke those fires, Gloria sent Becca a breezy text from the road relaying that she had a crazy story to tell her once she got back to the city. And did she want to do dinner tonight? That's it, she told herself. Keep it light. It was midday when she pulled up out front of the hole in the wall and parked once again beside McElroy's banana yellow Spitfire. Despite the bright light of day, the house looked dark and ominous to her now. She got out of the car and popped the hatchback. She took out a pry bar and mallet, which she'd had the forethought to purchase the day before, and carried them around to the side of the house. The overturned 5-gallon bucket and sheets of plywood were still here, but something had made off with what had remained of the watermelon. The equipment on the back patio remained untouched. 2 days ago, before they'd left the place, she had closed the double doors to the house, but she hadn't locked them. She went to them now, pulled them open. During the drive up, a part of her wondered what she would do if she opened these doors and saw that something had eaten a hole in the side of the large wooden crate. But that was not the case. The crate was intact, looking no different than it had when she'd first laid eyes on it. She pried the naugahyde sofa away from the wall, dragged it across the floor, and positioned it against the side of the crate. It was crudely constructed, she saw, with 2x4s forming the framework and the sheets of plywood serving as the walls of this... this what? Prison was the first thought that came to her. Cage was the second. But those terms were wrong. Those were terms reserved for items that held living things captive. If what Davis McElroy had told her was accurate, she should find nothing inside this large wooden box but a John Fish novel and the printed pages of McElroy's screenplay.
That book didn't want me working on it. It was like that book didn't want that screenplay to exist at all.
Gloria climbed onto the sofa, wedged the pry bar between the plywood and the 2x4, and then brought down the mallet. 11. What she found inside the crate was another crate. Small yet similarly constructed as the outer one, the revelation of this crate within a crate reminded her of those Russian nesting dolls. This association was only compounded when she opened that crate to find yet another inside.
He really did lose his mind out here.
And for a moment she wondered what she would do if she opened the final one only to find... what? Pandora's box, he'd called it.
Despite the old adage, I guess you could say I'm trying to close it back up.
There was another wooden crate inside the third one, only this one was not comprised of those sturdy 2x4s and sections of plywood. This one had been rendered more hastily, cobbled together with what appeared to be whatever random scraps of wood McElroy had collected, then haphazardly hammered together. It was like the crude Neanderthal ancestor of the outer crates. Instead of 2x4s for the frame, McElroy had dismantled, then utilized pieces from the wooden bench that had once been out back. He'd utilized the birdhouses too, their little wooden perches still poking out from the woodwork. She took a break at that point, not because her hands were growing numb and were cultivating blisters, which they were, but because the madness that had fueled McElroy to build this eccentric monstrosity felt like it was needling its way into her own brain. Madness by osmosis. Her cell phone rang. It was Becca. No doubt she had heard about the brouhaha at Bertoli's last night by now. Gloria didn't have it in her to engage in conversation, particularly about the events of last night, so she let it go to voicemail. As she did so, she recognized that McElroy had probably done the same thing every time she'd called. The thought of this made her lightheaded.
Madness by osmosis.
And she staggered outside to gulp down fresh air before continuing her work. 12. The interior boxes were flimsier, like she was getting to the soft, tender core of this excavation. The fury with which they'd evidently been constructed, not to mention the supplies McElroy had used, made them look angrier, too. Bits of chair rail, a scuffled tabletop, a section of headboard, slats from some bookshelf, McElroy had used whatever he'd had on hand at first. It was almost as if... she froze. A ragged hole, smaller than a fist, had been chewed through one panel of cheap wood. Not chewed, she corrected herself. Why would I think that? She busted away that panel and discovered a similarly sized hole in the box within. The wood was no more than cheap particle board. Probably it had once been a bookshelf or something. But sure as shit, it looked undeniably like something had tried to eat its way out. She dropped the pry bar and mallet on the floor and stood staring at the hole. The impossibility of McElroy's claim echoed back to her now.
I could hear it moving around inside, chewing its way through the wood.
No, she said this aloud with deliberate authority. Outside, her cell phone was ringing again. No way. I'm just spooking myself. And she laughed. Because he had gotten to her, hadn't he? those bleak, haunted eyes of his. In her head, she kept seeing him launch across the top of the table at Bertoli's, the steak knife gleaming as it tore through the fabric of Fish's necktie, Jack's high-pitched shriek as he tried to extract his hand from McElroy's manic handshake. Davis McElroy himself had made those holes. Nothing more. 13. The final box wasn't something Davis McElroy had cobbled together for himself. It was a large cigar box made of Spanish cedar that, to Gloria, looked for all the world like a miniature coffin. She could see McElroy had nailed the lid shut, creating a perimeter of spiky nail heads around the circumference of the lid. The jagged hole in the center of the cigar box's lid gave her pause, but simultaneously beckoned her toward it. She resisted the urge to get on her hands and knees and peek inside.
"Pop something in my head, right behind my eye."
And instead went out into the yard and returned with the hammer McElroy had used to demolish his laptop. She could have spent several minutes prying those nails, one by one, out of the cheap cedar lid of the cigar box. Instead, she brought the hammer down once, solidly. The lid collapsed, and she picked away the pieces. Inside was a tattered paperback edition of John Fish's novel, The Skin of Her Teeth. Nothing otherworldly, nothing vile or supernatural or dangerous about it. Just a book. Beneath the book was a thick stack of white bonded pages bound at the margin by brass pins. She brushed the paperback aside and gazed down at the cover page. The Skin of Her Teeth. Screenplay by Davis McElroy, based on the novel by John Fish.
"Thank you, thank you, thank you," she muttered, and scooped it out of the cigar box.
She flipped through the pages, gleaning the passages of direction and dialogue, taking it in. That crazy son of a bitch had actually completed it before losing his mind. Well, not exactly completed. She noticed that the last few pages of the screenplay were blank, and that the text actually ended on page 79. Not quite a full feature-length screenplay, but close. If it held together, if it wasn't a complete shit show, in other words, she could negotiate another writer into the contract to complete it. Hell, she'd pay the goddamn WGA scale out of her own commission just to ensure the deal went through. There were a few bloody fingerprints on some of the pages, dried to an angry russet color. More peculiar was a damp, pinkish substance on some of the blank pages that adhered to Gloria's fingertips like slime. It was tacky and smelled vaguely organic. She glanced down into the cigar box and noticed the same substance adhering to the foredge of the book, too. Like the rattling chains of Marley's ghost, McElroy's voice once again rose up in her head.
"It wasn't just physical," he had told her. "It was getting in my head, too. Twisting my thoughts. Waging war on an internal scale like some kind of parasite."
She forced the voice to be silent. Then she grabbed the screenplay and shoved it in her purse along with her cell phone. She was about to leave when she looked back at the paperback copy of The Skin of Her Teeth, the dog-eared trade paperback that had terrorized her client for the better part of a month. In the end, she cleaned the slimy gunk from its pages with a Kleenex, then dumped the book into her purse too. 14. Despite her exhaustion, she sped back to the city that evening, buoyed by the satisfaction that, despite all the strange twists and turns of the past few days, she had rescued the Paramount deal after all. As she drove, she ran through a mental Rolodex of clients whom she could rely on to complete the screenplay. She came up with several, but also realized that each one, no matter how reliable, would need time. Time to read and digest all that McElroy had written. Then even more time to compose their own thoughts on how to finish it. Not to mention even more time if they hadn't already read Fish's novel. Time was something Gloria didn't have. If she didn't get this thing to the executives at Paramount before the end of the week, then she'd gone up to the hole in the wall and spent the better part of her afternoon dismantling a lunatic's elaborate woodworking project for nothing, which left her with only one real solution. She would finish the damn thing herself. She wasn't a writer by nature or trade, but it wasn't brain surgery. Based on what she'd glimpsed while flipping through the pages back at the house, she really only needed to tag on an ending. And she had read John Fish's novel. She could make it work. She called Jack Bear, told him she was in possession of the prize and that she would have it sent to his office before the end of the week. Per his contract with the studio, Fish had final approval of the screenplay, but Jack agreed that she should also send it to the brass at Paramount as soon as possible, too, and not drag their feet on this. She didn't tell Jack that McElroy had failed to write the ending. That secret she would take to her grave. "So, is the damn thing any good?" he asked, the tone of his voice suggesting he doubted it was. "I'm going to read it tonight. I'll let you know first thing tomorrow. How's Fish? Stitched up and back home. Feel free to call him and give him the good news." "Right," Jack said. "The good news." She could sense something in his voice, some measure of trepidation, it sounded like. "Am I missing something, Jack? Is something else going on here?" "You mean other than your client's attempt on my client's life?" "No, Gloria, everything is just peachy." He was lying, she knew, but she was in too much of a whirlwind to slow down now. Anyway, she didn't need Jack Bauer, that old worrywart, to corrupt her good mood. She hung up with Jack and immediately called Susan Abrams, vice president of development at the studio. She got Abrams' voicemail, so she relayed her good news and said she'd be in touch. "The hostage negotiator saves another one," she thought as she piloted Becca's Nautilus toward the Lincoln Tunnel and into the city. 15. There was some blowback as a result of her having ignored Becca's phone calls all afternoon, not to mention the fact that Becca had learned about what had transpired the night before at Bertoli's from a Yahoo News article as opposed to her own girlfriend. "Becca, I feel like I've been running a relay race for the past few days," she said, her phone on speaker while she dug through a carton of leftover Kung Pao chicken at her kitchen table. She had McElroy's screenplay in front of her and was skimming the dialogue while she ate and as she attempted to placate Becca. Whatever madness had erupted inside Davis McElroy's head this past month, she was relieved to find that it hadn't translated to the page. "You could have been killed last night, Gloria, and I have to learn about it from the goddamn internet." "Look, Becca, I said I was sorry. I didn't use my best judgment, but really those news articles are full of hyperbole. It really wasn't as crazy as all that." "Are you kidding me? Your client is in jail on attempted murder charges, and that writer was taken away in an ambulance with a steak knife sticking out of his forearm. And you were there for the whole thing." "He didn't need an ambulance," she clarified, as if that changed anything. "It was just a precaution." Becca sighed heavily on the other end of the line. "I think I'm going to need some time," she said. Gloria turned to the next page of the screenplay. "Some time for what?" "Some time away from all this." Gloria looked at her phone. "All this?"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.